Look at those spectacular images.
What we have been trying to achieve is to develop strategies that allow us to watch the behavior of these individual oligodendrocyte precursor cells and also the myelinating oligodendrocytes in the intact brain of living animals.
Congratulations to Professor Dwight Burgles, who has won the 2020 Brancic Prize for Innovation in Multiple Sclerosis Research and a cool $100,000 US. This is for his work in remyelination in a mouse model of MS and creating incredible three-dimensional in vivo videos of remyelination, the regeneration of myelin from oligodendrocyte precursor cells, and using two-photon imaging to create incredible pictures and advancing our understanding of remyelination. And he'll also explain how this information can be used to help people living with MS. And I'll explain his research, and it will be followed by an interview with Professor Burgles himself. Let's have some fun. We'll start with a little background. In the central nervous system, myelin, the fatty sheath of nerve fibers, is formed by cells called oligodendrocytes. And it turns out the precursors to these cells, known as oligodendrocyte precursor cells, or OPCs, shown here, are abundant in the lesions. And that's one of the reasons that people can have such a good recovery from multiple sclerosis relapses, because these cells can differentiate into active myelinating oligodendrocytes and regrow myelin and restore function. However, for unknown reasons, this process of remyelination is often impaired or does not occur at all. And that's why we have to learn to train these oligodendrocyte precursor cells to grow myelin and potentially improve neurological problems in people with multiple sclerosis. This particular study uses a mouse model of multiple sclerosis using the demyelinating agent cuprizone, seen to the right. This is a toxin which chelates or takes up copper, depriving the electron transport chain from using this mineral, and the result is oxidative stress and the generation of reactive oxygen species, causing injury to oligodendrocytes and demyelination similar to what we see in multiple sclerosis. After the toxin is held, the mouse then recovers and we see remyelination and often an impressive reversal of paralysis. Of course, mice are not humans, and cuprizone-induced demyelination is not exactly the same as multiple sclerosis, but it's a very good way to study the process of remyelination. This slide shows the loss in oligodendrocytes in the mice treated with cuprizone, which occurs in the shaded area. The mice getting cuprizone you can see in yellow versus controls in blue, and as the mice recover, the rate of loss of oligodendrocyte goes back to zero. And you can also color code the specific cells, so the old oligodendrocytes in black disappear almost completely, but the new oligodendrocytes you can see take over in green. The researchers wanted to see remyelination in real time, so they used a very special form of microscopy called two-photon imaging, which I'll explain in a moment, and they did it through a cranial window, which is a surgical procedure done over a very specific area of the mouse brain called the barrel field of the somatosensory cortex. The somatosensory cortex receives sensory input, such as fine touch, from the opposite side of the mouse's body, and it has unique histological properties, making it the optimal area to see oligodendrocytes in action. Now, normally it would be very difficult to see oligodendrocytes in a cluster of neurons, axons, other glial cells, and interstitial components. And so the researchers used this very special fluorescent protein called enhanced green fluorescent protein. And if you cause this gene to be expressed throughout the mouse, you can actually make them glow in the dark. And you can see the two mutant mice compared to the normal mouse on the inside. And you can actually get these mutant mice as pets. They're totally normal, except they glow under a black light. However, these researchers did something ingenious. They took a structural gene for myelin, coding for myelin-associated oligodendrocyte basic protein, MOBP, and they fused it to the gene EGFP, enhanced green fluorescent protein, so that specifically the oligodendrocytes would fluoresce, making them easy to visualize under the microscope. But even with fluorescent oligodendrocytes, it could be very difficult to get a high-resolution image at a deeper depth because you have different oligodendrocytes reflecting light at different depths, interfering and scattering light. And so a very special form of microscopy is done, known as two-photon imaging. Here, you use photons with a lower energy at the far red or near infrared wavelength ranges, and these two photons are absorbed by the tissues when they're delivered at exactly the same time, and they must be delivered within a femtosecond, and then they give off radiation in the light range, which is absorbed by the microscope and creates a beautiful image. And so you can see this is a diagram of the infrared laser being absorbed two photons at exactly the same depth, and you get beautiful images like this, where you can see the oligodendrocytes, the cell body, and all of the projections. Click like if you're impressed by the brilliance and beauty of modern science. But Burgos and his team took it one step further, taking images at the same location, at the same depth, and creating a movie which begins before and then after Cuprizone, showing demyelination and remyelination. So you can see the baseline oligodendrocytes and their projections. And as we start the movie, you can see 1 week, 2 weeks of Cuprizone, there's demyelination and new oligodendrocytes and their projections form, and they look almost identical to baseline oligodendrocytes. They then took it one step further and used computer software to fuse the slices together to create three-dimensional movies that they could rotate in real time, and they color-coded the old and new oligodendrocytes. So here you can see the oligodendrocytes at baseline, and you can see the image rotate, and then they receive Cuprizone, 1 week, 2 weeks of Cuprizone, and you can see the loss of oligodendrocytes, and then you start to see the recovery, 3 days, 5 days, 1 week recovery, 10 days recovery, more and more oligodendrocytes in new locations remyelinating the same axons. And then after 5 weeks, you can see the color coding. Look at those spectacular images with the old oligodendrocytes in purple and the new oligodendrocytes in neon green. Now, this article was more than just pretty pictures. The authors did very detailed quantitative analysis of the oligodendrocytes and myelin sheaths, and these are some of their conclusions. For one, baseline oligodendrocytes and regenerated oligodendrocytes were extremely similar. As you saw, they had very similar structural morphology, and it turned out the regenerated cells actually produced slightly more myelin. However, if you looked at individual myelin segments, the internodes between the two nodes of Ranvier, so the segments of myelin, only about half that were lost, that were demyelinated, were actually replaced, and 32.4% were lost, not replaced entirely, and 47.6% were in completely new, previously unmyelinated areas. In other words, you don't remyelinate the same axons for some reason, and as you saw, the oligodendrocytes form in new regions. Also, depth, in other words, depth from the surface of the brain, seems to play a factor. At the very superficial zone, the top 100 micrometers, oligodendrocyte recovery was highly efficient, 85% recovery. But as you went deeper, there was more gliosis and scar tissue and other changes. So what is special about the top 100 micrometers, and how can you use that information to improve oligodendrocyte precursor cell differentiation? And this slide just shows how objectively similar the old and new oligodendrocytes were. You can see the control cells in blue and the remyelinating oligodendrocytes in orange. The average and distribution of sheath length of the myelin is virtually identical. Professor Burgos is also involved in a lot of other research on oligodendrocytes, and these are some of his other conclusions from other research projects. His team discovered that the oligodendrocyte precursor cells actually interact with neurons, not just the axons, the nerve fibers, and the neurons actually influence oligodendrocyte precursor cell differentiation. Exactly how this occurs is unknown. Also, although we think of OPCs as the sort of good guys, the cells that could potentially remyelinate, it turns out they actually present antigen and may be involved in MS inflammation. So they may be sort of a double-edged sword, and we have to figure out how to regulate these cells. Also, it's well known that older mice don't remyelinate as well, and they discovered specific changes in the proteome, in other words, the expressed proteins of the oligodendrocyte precursor cells, and this influences the efficiency of mouse remyelination. So what specific proteins are causing this aging and impaired remyelination, and how can we influence that to help people with MS? And to answer more of our questions, I'm honored to introduce the man with the plan himself, the Brancic Prize 2020 winner, Professor Dwight Burgles. Just to tell you a little bit about his background, he has an undergraduate degree in biology from Boston University, a PhD in molecular and cellular physiology from Stanford University, along with postdoctoral training at Oregon Health Science University. He has an extensive career with many publications on the topic of nervous system development and communication and oligodendrocytes and remyelination and advanced in real time in vivo imaging. Thank you for taking the time to do the interview.
Thanks, Brandon. It's a pleasure to be here.
So how are things going in the Baltimore area in terms of the pandemic? Are things finally getting a little bit better there?
I think so. You know, we've been holding steady for quite a while now. We have a governor who communicates well, I think, and, you know, people have been very compliant with masks work. And so I think if we can just keep that up for a bit longer, maybe we'll pull out of it in the area.
I'm optimistic as well. I know 2020 was a terrible year in terms of the world, but a great year in terms of your career. I mean, congratulations on winning the Brancic Prize. I mean, it's a tremendous achievement. You look at some of the names of the people, you know, Jonah Chan, Quintana last year. It really is an honor. How does it feel to make it to the pinnacle?
It feels a surprise. It feels wonderful. It feels like a real acknowledgement, I think, personally, for the work that my group has done over the years. And, you know, although I'm standing here accepting the prize, this is really a reflection of the work that some very, very talented, committed people have done over the years. You know, this is the way it is in science is, you know, as you become successful, you tend to spend more time managing the success of others. And certainly that has been my trajectory. And so when I look at this body of work, although my own interest in oligodendrocyte precursors and oligodendrocytes began in graduate school, that has evolved, you know, to really leverage the talents of a lot of trainees, graduate students, and postdoctoral fellows in my lab over the last 20 years. And that, you know, is incredibly gratifying to me to see that work rewarded in this way.
Well, you know, as a clinician, I definitely understand the idea of standing on the shoulders of giants. I'm definitely waiting for smarter people like you to come up with better treatments in MS so that I can take the credit for it.
Great. We're working on that.
So, you know, just to start off, I mean, I never imagined when I was an undergraduate student or a medical student, you could ever see three-dimensional videos like that in a living organism. How do you create those videos? How is that even possible?
Yeah, so the work that you're referring to is really, I think, where we have eventually come to in the lab. And it has been a long road, and it is a process that requires a lot of investment at different levels. And so what we have been trying to achieve is to develop strategies that allow us to watch the behavior of these individual oligodendrocyte precursor cells and also the myelinating oligodendrocytes in the intact brain of living animals. And it is as challenging as it sounds, maybe, because what we're talking about is seeing individual cells and watching them move, watching them interact with other cell types, watching them undergo differentiation in the intact nervous system of animals that are living out their lives. So it's, you know, a lot of science that has been done over the last decades, you know, involves studies of fixed tissue, you know, stuff that's been soaked in formaldehyde, and you cut it up and you look at the cells and tissue sections, or you remove the cells from their normal environment and you grow them in a petri dish. But of course, those are one, it's fixed tissue, so it's not living. You can't study dynamic changes very easily that way. And then in the second case of like taking the cells out, and they're in a dish, so they're removed from their normal environment. And because they engage in all of this interaction with the other cells in the nervous system, when you take them out, they change their properties. And so it's kind of hard to study what their normal behavior is. So we've been working, you know, progressively to try to develop these techniques that allow us to visualize the cells in the intact brain. And so just to give you the short synopsis of this kind of science fiction, what we do is we first harness molecular genetics. So we generate new lines of mice, transgenic lines, where we actually insert genes into the chromosomes of these mice, which allow fluorescent proteins to be expressed in specific cells. So these are proteins that glow in different colors when they're excited by light. And this allows us to actually just see those cells and see their very fine processes, like, for example, individual myelin sheets that are expressed by the oligodendrocytes. So you have to have the kind of the genetic engineering working, and then you have to master surgeries. So like a surgeon, you have to learn how to work on mice. And what we do is we actually remove a portion of the skull of the mouse, and then we replace it with a little glass window, which allows us to then look inside the brain of these mice. We seal that up with cement. And basically after that surgery, the animals will live a normal life. It just, they'll have a little window on their brains. And then we can take those mice and then put them underneath a microscope. Now it's a big microscope, has a laser that alone costs $150,000 to $200,000, but it has some really fancy tricks to it, which allows us to visualize the cells within the intact brain. And so we take the mice and then we put them underneath the microscope, and then we look inside the brains, and we can get amazing resolution. So both in the spatial sense, that is, we can see the fine structure of the cells, and then we also have good temporal resolution. So we can see things that are happening on time scales of less than a second, all the way up to things that are happening over several months. Because we can take that same mouse and we can repeatedly bring it to the microscope, go back to the same area of the brain, find the same cell that we were imaging weeks or even months before, we can ask how that cell has changed. And in the case of the oligodendrocyte progenitors, we can actually ask whether these cells have divided, whether they've moved through the tissue, whether they've undergone differentiation to become an oligodendrocyte. So we can ask a lot of really sophisticated questions about the behavior of the cells like never before using this technology.
So, you know, in looking at these videos, to me, the new and old oligodendrocytes, they look pretty much the same, but there are differences. Like, what would you say are the key differences? What have we learned so far?
Good. Lots of interesting questions there. I would reverse that and say one thing that we were, I think, surprised about was that the new oligodendrocytes look so similar to ones that are normally generated in the brain. You know, the one thing about the generation of oligodendrocytes and myelin is that it has a very long time course. So this is not something that is done in humans by the time you're 5 years old or something like that. This is something that has a very long trajectory, and we're still making oligodendrocytes into adulthood. So it's a process that goes on for a long time, and this is enabled by the persistence of these oligodendrocyte progenitor cells, which remain abundant in the adult nervous system. And so we thought, you know, that under a situation where you have lost the oligodendrocytes, where they've been destroyed, and you're regenerating new ones, that the new cells would have like a really different morphology. You'd think that, you know, they have, if you will, infinite territory, you know, to myelinate all sorts of axons that they didn't myelinate before, and maybe they would have really unusual morphologies. But what we found is that the cells were essentially the same size. And if I, you know, were to scramble a bunch of, you know, tracings of the cells and showed them to you, or to me, I would not be able to pick out the ones that were newly generated. So they were slightly larger, but in general, they look very, very similar. So that tells us one thing, that is that there's very strong, like, cell intrinsic control. Like, an oligodendrocyte has a certain capability of the number of myelin sheaths that it can form, even when given vast territory to myelin. So the main differences we saw were really more related to a little bit longer sheaths than you would see normally. But that subtle change was pretty much it at the level of analysis that we were doing so far.
So, you know, it seems like remyelination is a very fickle thing. I know one of the things you found is that it's very efficient superficially in the cortex, like the top 100 micrometers, but is much less efficient deeper. So there's something about the surrounding environment. Like, why is that? Why would there be such a dramatic difference?
Great question. And, you know, a lot of what we've looked at with regard to myelin, certainly from the standpoint of remyelination, has been studies of white matter. And there's technical reasons for that. It's relatively, the structure of myelin is highly ordered in white matter because the axons are all oriented parallel to each other. And so it's much easier to use things like MRI to visualize myelin changes in white matter. But in gray matter, it's much more difficult. Myelin itself is disordered because the axons themselves are disordered. And so it's harder to get a signal out, which gives you an indication. So a lot of what we know about myelin comes from studies of white matter. We're just starting to look at gray matter. And so that was one of the things that we have been exploring, is what is the structure of myelin in gray matter now? So this is the region of the brain which is so important for cognitive function, higher order processes, things like that. And so we really do need to know about the structure of myelin, which types of neurons are getting myelin, how much myelin do they have, how well is that myelin repaired on specific types of neurons. These are all the important questions that we're just starting to answer now using the approaches that I mentioned. So you alluded to this idea that the repair process is not uniform, and that was really quite striking in our experiments. So we used a method where we feed animals a toxin which is sort of specific to oligodendrocytes. It's a copper chelator which kills oligodendrocytes. It's just a tool that we use to basically destroy oligodendrocytes as if they were destroyed by the immune system. And then we watch them regenerate. And using this approach, what we found was that the upper layers of the cortex were very efficient at repair. So they could regenerate the oligodendrocytes that were up to essentially the same number of cells that were present earlier before we, you know, destroyed them. But as we went deeper into the cortex, we found that there was less and less repair, such that, you know, by about midway down into the cortex, you were only getting about half of the cells back that you had originally. So this is really, really inefficient. And we carried the animals out, you know, doing this repetitive imaging for several months. And we, you know, can kind of extrapolate that repair process. And basically what it showed us is that the animals would never actually repair sufficiently. And it's strange because it's sort of like, I don't know how to make a proper analogy, but, you know, the way that we're thinking about this now is that the progenitors that are there may have been subjected to some sort of like trauma. So they almost have like PTSD. So there was a destruction, there was, you know, oligodendrocytes that were killed in this area. And the important additional information I have to tell you about is that there's more myelin as you go deeper into the cortex. So there were more cells destroyed, there was more debris created when those myelinating cells were killed. And so that kind of like environment or inflammatory environment, we think might alter fundamentally the progenitor cells and reduce their probability of actually undergoing differentiation later. So it's almost like they have a memory of having experienced that environment, which then prevents them from eventually catching up. Because what you might think is that, well, okay, if there's more oligodendrocytes in deeper layers, I could imagine that it might take longer to repair. You have to generate more cells, you know, to eventually reach the same number, but they never do this. So even given enough time, they never catch up. So this suggests to us that really fundamentally something is altered in those cells. It's also possible, or maybe in addition, that the environment that they're in is also altered as a consequence of having undergone that damage. So it's a very interesting phenomenon. I think we're excited about that. We're excited about that failure to remyelinate, because again, what we're trying to understand is why things fail to remyelinate. We know that, you know, in MS, that is a primary eventuality in the disease, is that, you know, there are permanent lesions where we're not able to regenerate oligodendrocytes and restore myelin. And so we can model this in a mouse model. Now we can start to tease apart, you know, what are some of the mechanisms that's preventing those cells from undergoing differentiation, which may provide us with new strategies for promoting differentiation of progenitors in MS.
I mean, ultimately, we would want to make the cells that are deeper sort of do what the more superficial cells are doing, I suppose. You know, but it's interesting because in the clinic, people with MS, even if they have very deep lesions, you know, people can make spectacular recoveries, you know, particularly younger people with relapsing MS, but sometimes older people as well. And it just seems like there's so much variability between person to person. Some people could have a very dense paralysis and recover 95%, whereas other people may have 20% recovery. And, you know, I know mice aren't humans, but are there any like hypotheses you have as to why, you know, remyelination might maybe more efficient in some people versus others?
That's a great question. You know, we use generally for these types of experiments, we try to use inbred strains, because we're dealing with so many variables on our own, you know, but of course, inbred strains of mice don't mimic like the diversity of humankind.
Right.
So I think you're absolutely right. And I imagine if we were to repeat these experiments in, let's say, outbred strains of mice, we might see much more variability. So the hope is that by studying an inbred strain where things are a little bit more controlled and uniform, we might understand those cases where there isn't regeneration that would apply to people that don't do well in regeneration. But it's a fair point that, you know, how is it that some people are able to do it so well? So it's possible we might get information about that because they have a variant in, you know, some sort of gene that's involved in communication or sensitivity to some of the cytokines that are released by cells. You know, it could lead in that direction, but of course, we don't know that yet.
Yeah. And so to switch gears a little bit, you know, we're talking about OPCs as the good cells. We need these cells to remyelinate. We have to train them to remyelinate better. But some of your other research suggests that they may be involved in inflammation in MS. They may be sort of co-opted by the immune system a little bit. Can you explain that?
Yeah. I think to even back up a little bit further, one of the things that we spend a lot of time in the lab talking about is whether or not what we call OPCs, these oligodendrocyte precursor cells, are really only that. That is this the only thing that these cells do in the nervous system? Are they kept around just for the sole purpose of making new oligodendrocytes? And that is an important question to answer, because it's possible that when we look in human tissue, where we believe there are lots of OPCs, we can see them. It may be that those cells are actually not cells that are even capable of undergoing differentiation to become oligodendrocytes. And so there are a lot of things that make us suspicious that these OPC cells may have other functions in the nervous system. They're clearly very, very abundant, and they're kept in the nervous system throughout life, even though the generation of oligodendrocytes declines, you know, as we age. And you can even find these cells in regions of the nervous system where there's no myelin at all, which already starts to make you wonder, like maybe they are doing other things, like in the cerebellar molecular layer, there's no myelin, but you find these progenitor cells. So they might be doing other things. And one of the major advances that has been happening is our ability to genetically interrogate the cells. So we do this by, again, generating transgenic mice where we can visualize them, and it allows us to purify these cells from the brain. And then we can start to look at what genes these cells are expressing. So it gives us it's kind of like phenotyping, or, you know, it's a way of characterizing the properties of these cells. And you can see lots of things in the cells that are not obviously linked to the generation of oligodendrocytes, supporting the idea that they may have other roles in the nervous system, like acting as a kind of like a surveillance mechanism, like looking for alterations in the environment, the way that microglia do. So they're another major type of they're the primary like innate immune cell in the nervous system. They're always looking around for damaged cells or viruses or other sorts of damage to the CNS. So it's possible that OPCs and microglial cells are working in partnership to kind of maintain the environment within the brain. And that's something that we're exploring right now. So I think these are really, really important questions to ask. And the issue that you were mentioning, this co-opting of the immune system, was based on work that was really pioneered by my colleague Peter Calabresi at Hopkins, who has shown that these cells, in response to certain inflammatory molecules, will present antigen on their surface. So it gets quite complex, but it's a way of sort of marking cells, tagging cells for removal by the nervous system or for engaging immune cells. And so the fact that they start to express these components, which allow them to signal with other immune cells, suggests that they may be playing an active role in modulating the immune response by communicating to other immune cells, by perhaps even targeting themselves for destruction, things like that. So it's a really new phenomenon that we're looking at. And one of the cool techniques that we've developed is, again, harnessing this power of molecular genetics. We've created new lines of mice which allow us to visualize just those progenitor cells which have turned on this pathway. So we can now track just those specific progenitor cells that are engaging in this kind of communication to see, you know, what cells are they interacting with? What happens to those cells? Are those the ones that don't ever differentiate into oligodendrocytes, or are they removed from the nervous system? So it's a very powerful way of exploring kind of like the ultimate fate of those cells.
Very interesting. Yeah, I mean, I know that microglia have been known to cause inflammation, particularly in progressive MS, and yes, they were thought to be a possible drug target for abutilast and other drugs, but I had no idea OPCs could be the bad guys in any way. So very interesting. I'm interested to see how that goes. You know, I know I'm like a clinician, so we're very impatient. We want results now. You know, we want to be able to use drugs on our patients. What do you think is the next step, you know, for your research in 2021, 2022, and how can we take this information to help actual humans with MS? I mean, we know that opicinumab doesn't seem to work, anti-lingo. I have a video on that if anyone wants to take a look. Clomastine, the drug Tavist, may work. It's still being investigated. I have a video on that if anyone wants to take a look. What do you think the next step is?
Well, these are really great questions. And I think one of the things that's been so exciting is the ability to repurpose FDA-approved drugs for promoting the differentiation of OPCs. So what we think and what we see in MS lesions is that there are cells that appear to be progenitor cells that persist that are not generating new oligodendrocytes, leading to progressive disability. And so one of the major, I think, thrust right now is to try to develop strategies, compounds, that will enhance the ability of those remaining progenitor cells to undergo differentiation. And so there have been a number of screens that have been conducted in vitro just looking for things that will promote that differentiation. You mentioned clemastine, but there looks like there's a whole host of other compounds. And one of the things that makes us very excited is that genetic interrogation of the cells that we're conducting tells us that they express a whole host of receptors on their surface. These are receptors for which drugs have already been developed. And so by understanding what those receptors are used for in the cells, we might be able to pick and choose a few that would enhance the ability of the cells to undergo differentiation or to proliferate, to replace themselves, things like that. So I think this is an extremely exciting time in the field where we're starting to really develop things that could be delivered to patients right now. I think the other advantage that we have in the kind of the platform that I described for you, which is a way of visualizing with high resolution these cells and their oligodendrocytes, is it allows us to take some of these compounds and put them into animals and then look with high resolution, like what exactly are they doing? Are they really inducing the differentiation of the cells? Are they promoting the survival of the cells? The cells that they induce to differentiate, do they stably integrate and form myelin? Does that myelin look exactly the same as the original myelin? Are they myelinating the same types of neurons? So these are the kinds of like really detailed questions that we can get now that will help us to understand how these compounds are acting in people, we think. So I think that, you know, starting to take these compounds now and putting them into this model could give us some real insight into, one, the way that these compounds are acting, and maybe come up with some reasonable strategies to improve their function, to increase their efficacy, things like that.
Yeah,
so
you
this
know,
is really happening right now in the lab. So it's a very exciting time.
Yeah, you know, when I read your article, I thought of Jonah Chan's work with the micropillar array and wrapping them with myelin, and thought of your work as sort of an advance on that, where you could more clearly and objectively measure oligodendrocyte growth. So
absolutely.
I'd be interested to see if that's what you're actually
Brandon.
Interested in working on.
Yeah, exactly, Brandon. I mean, that's really one of the reasons that motivated us to embark on this is, as I have to say, sort of like dissatisfaction with our ability to study this process. So the ways that people study remyelination is largely done, you know, in animal models, largely done with histology. In people, it's done with MRI, you know, and this is extremely low resolution. You know, that's it's like, you know, one little dot or pixel in an MRI is hundreds of thousands of cells. And so you really don't know what's happening in that volume. You don't really know what's happening there. And so I firmly believe that, you know, this kind of high resolution analysis shows us what these compounds are doing, but also informs us about what we should be doing. You know, what is it that we're actually trying to achieve? What aspect of this process is failing? And it seems maybe ridiculous to the audience here and patients for that we could even be asking that question. You know, it certainly is that we're just, you know, we're not generating myelin. And that's true, but it's the question is like, why is it that we're not generating myelin? There are many ways that this problem, you know, could exist. And that's really the goal of the science that we're doing, is to try to navigate this and really establish what the problem is. And once we understand that in a very detailed way, then we're going to be in a much better position to develop, you know, strategies to overcome that.
Yeah, I mean, I think what we've learned so far is very optimistic. When I saw the autopsy studies of Bruce Trapp showing that even older people with advanced progressive MS have oligodendrocyte precursor cells in the lesions, that gives us something to work on. So I'm very optimistic for the future.
Yes, and the other thing that's probably worth noting here, the reason to be optimistic is that these cells show incredible homeostasis. And what I mean by that is that when you remove these cells from the brain, it's not as if you deplete them. It's not like you know, people talk about the brain in ways of typically like neurons, that you're born with all the neurons you'll ever have. So if you kill your neurons, you're just, you know, you're going to lose function over time. The amazing thing about these progenitor cells is they retain the ability to proliferate, and they are exquisitely designed to keep their numbers constant in the brain. So you can take numbers of these cells out, make them become oligodendrocytes, and the remaining cells will divide to replace the ones that were removed. And so that gives me certainly a lot of hope that you know, that this is a very robust resource that the brain can use to initiate repair. It has the progenitor cells. I mean, this has been a huge problem in other neurological diseases and disorders, is that, you know, if you want to make new neurons, how do you do it? You know, people are talking about actually taking glia and forcing them to become neurons, like OPCs or other cells. But, you know, the advantage we have here is that there's already a robust system in place to generate the cells of interest. So yes, we're just hoping that we can find ways of really accelerating that differentiation process and harnessing their innate ability.
Yeah, so you know, very interesting. Hopefully we'll make progress in the next 5 years. You know, now I have to ask you this question. You won a $100,000 prize. What are you going to do with the money? Don't tell me you're going to donate it to charity or use it on research. You got to splurge at least a little bit, right?
So I have one child in college, and I have two. I have twin girls that are in high school. So right away, you know where the money's going to go. But No, I'm a very deliberate, cautious person. I've thought about those kinds of things. I think, what you didn't mention in my background is I actually started in science wanting to be a marine biologist. And so, although scientists don't really have hobbies because we love what we do in science, and so we spend most or all of our time doing that, I do still love the marine environment, and I have, I like to go snorkeling and scuba diving. So I fantasized about maybe taking the family to see the Galapagos Islands or something like that. Some amazing trip like that, but nothing on the books as yet.
I have been to the Barrier Reef for my honeymoon,
Oh,
and it was
nice.
just incredible. So I would definitely
Fantastic.
recommend it. Well, thank you, Professor, for taking the time to do the interview. That was very helpful. And if anyone wants to take a look at some of those publications, I'll include them in the notes below. And if you have any questions, please post in the comments below.
Thank you, Brandon. It was my pleasure. Thanks a lot for doing this interview.